speaker for today, Mr. Rahul Dakuna. His organization has produced the famous Amul Topicals that has made India smile for 54 years.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for inviting me today to talk about perhaps my most favorite subject in the whole world, which is the Amul Topical Campaign. I'm going to try and do two things which will perhaps be of interest to you. The first part of this is to really talk about 55 years of a campaign that I'd like to believe has become iconic. I'd like to believe it has paved the way for a lot of advertising kids to come into the business because they sort of see that there is still humor in advertising. But also, I understand that many of you are entrepreneurs, many of you have your own businesses, some of you are advertising people. So I would like to also perhaps share the experiences that I've had both with this campaign. What are some of the lessons that I have learned in this process of mine, which is how a brand became the toast of a nation? You can expect me and excuse me for having already begun the punning. But this I've been told very often is that the Amul Topical Campaign is perhaps, and it is, the longest running advertising campaign, certainly the longest running outdoor campaign. So a little bit of history. Back in 65, my father, Sylvester Dacuna, and his art director at the time, Eustace Fernandez, were given it's the first account that Amul very kindly gave my father 55 years ago, which was the Amul Butter Campaign. And the brief was very simple. And that brief was, there is no brief. You have to figure out a way of selling butter to an audience where you don't have the benefit of photography necessarily. You don't have press advertising. Television hadn't been created yet. At least there was no advertising on TV as we know it. So the only medium that my poor father had was the outdoor medium. And it was very clearly told to him that our target audience is children. How do you talk to children when you don't have the benefit of photography? So I think really what I want to talk about is when you create something as long ago as 55 years, how do you sustain something that can last for so long? So some of the lessons that I will talk to you about today, I've imbibed in this brand building exercise, having worked on this Amul Topical Campaign for 27 years. I'd like to kick off with this quite interesting quote from McGraw-Hill. So around the time that a client is getting tired of his advertising, that's around the time that the consumer is noticing it. I think perhaps one of the many, many things that marketers, ad agencies, brand builders tend to do is they tend not to invest, not to think enough, not to say to themselves the rigor of what is our big idea? What is the long-term property that we need to imbibe, invest in our brand? I'm sorry to say that the mantra at the moment tends to be, let's get a celebrity and that celebrity will sell our brand. And every single consumer that we want to tempt to buy our product will buy it because Dhoni is selling it. So if Akshay Kumar is selling 5,000 products, let's get Akshay Kumar to sell it. That, my friends, is not the way I see it. There's a huge difference between what we loosely call a manufacturer's statement and the emotional benefit to the consumer. Another mistake, not a mistake, but I think the other habit that marketing people tend to go with, and perhaps owners of products who are so proud of what they have, they want to tell the consumer, listen, we've got this and we've got this and we've got that. And you know that we're going to launch this new motorcycle and it's not got two wheels, it's got three wheels and it's got 18 gears. And the consumer is saying, boss, I'm not sure that I want to hear so much information. What does it have for me emotionally? What is it that you are telling me? What is the benefit that is not produced in the factory? Levi's perhaps did it best and did it very early when it didn't. It said that we are much more than just blue jeans. We sell you sex appeal. So usually a benefit not produced in the factory is an emotional benefit. It tells me that it is something which I feel emotionally. It's not a manufacturer's state. And it usually takes the shape of a tagline or a brand property. So in 65, my father and Eustace, they came up with this. I'm only going to show a little part of her. But I think everybody knows this little girl with the blue hair and the polka dotted bow. And the line which funnily enough, my mother thought of. My father went home one day and sort of said, this is an utterly delicious. And she said, why not add butterly to it? And it's funny how sometimes out of conversations, great taglines are made. So these two properties, at that time, I don't think anybody knew would be so ageless. They were more created to be able to sell a brand at that point in time. And even then, nobody has this great eureka moment of saying, yes, this is the line, this is the property we're going to stay with. And so the very first ad that was thought of was very specifically to do with butter. It had the little girl in her non-anorexic avatar, slightly pudgy. But I think over a period of time, my father and the ad agency began to believe that what is the product feature that is not produced in the factory? Because there's only a certain amount that a butter can sell properties. And it was at this time that he spoke to Dr. Kurian, the great Dr. Kurian, the founder of Amul, and said, look, I want to create a campaign that is an outdoor campaign, specifically at this point in time, that does not necessarily herald the benefits of butter. But they will take topical events. They will take festivals. They will take film happenings. They will take politics sometimes. And they will comment on these in a cheeky way. And so the very first topical created back then was when the racing season had first started. So my father thought that it would be interesting to be able to combine the event and the bread. And so thus was born the quite interesting format of always linking the butter somehow to the event, but events became the hallmark of this campaign. Now, this is where we were very lucky in that my father did tell him, Dr. Kurian, that listen, we really do need to be able to not take your approval on this, because the rate at which our topicals need to happen, if there is a point of view, and people have points of view, the event itself will be old news by then. So can we seek your blessings in being able to not run it by you to get your approval? And this is something that has stayed with us for many, many years, that Dr. Kurian handed over many, many years later to Mr. Sodhi, Dr. Sodhi, who is the present MD of Amul, who believes in the same philosophy that, look, let the ad agency do what it does best. And so my second or third lesson would be, try and engage your client in the basic belief that if you can sell your product, we will try and sell you the promise. So some interesting advertising facts. Back in 75, we were running one topical a month. In 1995, it became one a week. What has happened in 2017 onwards is we run as many as 5 topicals a week. The weekly schedule of topics is planned on Mondays. Part of my job is to try and figure out what is the topic that is most relevant for that day. So folks, what we do is the three of us, the team of three, we're three people, Manish Javeri, the writer, Jayant Rani, the cartoonist, and myself, we plan for the week as to what is it that is vital on that Monday, what is it that can wait till the Wednesday, and what will climax perhaps around the Friday. So it's also a navigation point because there's so much going on. I mean, if you just take this one week, you have Biden winning, you have Kamala Harris with her India roots, you have Mr. Trump not allowing Biden to get into the White House. You got the Bihar elections. You got the Mumbai Indians winning the fifth title. So all these are hugely important topics. These are topics that everybody's talking about. Plus, there's a whole bunch of internet topics that also are being talked about. How do we navigate this? So the newspapers, as we call them, people still read the newspapers. They will give us the topic. But social media, this incredible game changer that we've all experienced over the last 7 or 8 years, gives you the trend and the way people are thinking. So where are we today? This is a very important point. We need to cut across boundaries and appeal to varied audiences. Now, you will understand and accept that in a country as vast as India, we've got a variety of languages, variety of topics, a variety of basic interests. I mean, what interests Bombay does not necessarily interest Bihar, right? Secondly, attention spans have lessened incredibly. I mean, there was a time when, like I said earlier, one particular topic could last you a month. Today, the Mumbai Indians winning was big news yesterday. By today, we've moved on. Biden now, once he takes office, suddenly now Bihar has become important. So the mind is so filled with information that there is no scope for anything to last for, I think, more than 24 hours. there is very often the need for localized and regional topicals. So this is a very important point that I would want to share with all of you. There is no such thing anymore as a national issue. I mean, there is, but for the most part, our interest is in what is happening outside our door. Our interest is what's happening in our community, what's happening in our state, in our city. I'm not really concerned about what is happening at the national scale unless it truly impacts me. So often topics are created only for social media. At any point, at any different point in time, and again, this is an important point, we have different topicals running across the country. Even within Mumbai city, most of you, I'm guessing a lot of you live in Mumbai city. South Bombay and North Bombay are like two different countries. South Bombay, the wonderful snob part of Bombay that we are, aren't really into Bollywood. We're into Hollywood. And Nobo, as we call it, is into Bollywood. So even our segmentation works quite differently, where a lot of the our hoardings also are broken up like that. So very often, if there's a Bollywood topical that is being seen in North Bombay, won't necessarily be seen here. So Amul reflects India, India reflects Amul. This is a vital lesson for all of you. There are five Indias in India. First is that huge country called Mumbai. Now, this was topical was done when in, was it 1998, when Mumbai was renamed from Bombay. Not an issue that most of India would care about, but for us, it was a very, very important point. Language, Kalipili, not a word that anybody outside of Bombay understands. But you go to Delhi and say, Kalipili mat karo, what do you mean Kalipili? So we punned on it using the classic battle that happened between the taxis and the private, whatever they call the private carriers. And when they were scrapping, clubs, Bombay Gymkhana had a whole issue about life membership. Now, this is an interesting point. I mean, U2 is really a Western phenomenon. They came to India and they came to Bombay. So this is a topic that only ran in Bombay, because U2 coming to town perhaps had some relevance in other cities as well. But it became a Bombay topic. This wonderful community of ours, the Parsis, they keep talking about increasing their tribe. But outside of Bombay, nobody really cares about it. Not post-COVID, but one of the things that have changed over the last couple of weeks is the fact that ladies can now take the train. Restaurants have opened. But restaurants have opened in Bombay, not anywhere outside of Bombay. The Hindi belt becomes a second huge part of India. Different from any other part of India, but they have, as you will all know, while Nitish Kumar takes over and sort of is the CM, which he's always been. But Bihar politics is a very specific, interesting aspect in the Hindi belt. Uttar Pradesh has always had its own issues. They're very specific, they're very political. Uttar Pradesh, across all the states that comprise the Hindi belt, they are very fond and very obsessed with their own politics. This gentleman is never out of the news. Today, his son has done quite well, while he's still in jail for the third time. So can you imagine this topic ran in 1998, when he went into jail for the first time. And today, 22 years later, there he is. When the two of them got together for the first time. This was a very popular topical when the young Jyoti Rao left the Congress and joined the BJP. The third is, of course, the East. The East has got is another world. Mamata Didi and her politics and the concerns of Bengal are all completely insular in how they feel. So it's also very important for us to be able to know what is happening. And for all of you, when you're doing your work for these markets, don't do a national campaign. You can't do a national campaign. You will reach out to your East friends and your Bengal buyers and the consumer with so much more empathy if you can talk the language, if you can reach out to the Bengali. And if you can always bring in Dada in some form. The South, I say the South with some amount of hesitation, because the South is made up of four huge states, all of whom have got their own issues, their own concerns, their own language. They are in very many ways cut off from the rest of the country, because Chennai does not speak Hindi. Tamil Nadu does not speak Hindi. Tamil Nadu does not watch Bollywood movies. So we are very careful when we do our Amul Bhatta hoardings. We have a whole separate team working on topicals for the South. When Andhra Pradesh was divided, perhaps the most popular and most famous of the ministers. This man is a national icon, but his movies will always have a special place in the hearts of South Indian people. And he can really do anything. And finally, the fifth India is social media. There are issues that we take care of that never see the light of day on a hoarding, because they are so specific to the screens that you look at every day, your Twitter handles, your Facebook pages, the various challenges that people... So people who are driving by in a car may see this on a hoarding and not know what it's about, because it's such a specific internet topic. Game of Thrones, again, an OTT platform, it never made it to the national television. So it's only if you're specifically an OTT person will you really appreciate this hugely popular TV show, Emojis. So my summation to this point is, don't assume that the country is one in terms of language and interests. You really genuinely, and I say this, it seems like an obvious point to make, but far too often do I see campaigns that are done holistically, and that's really not something. I mean, of course you can. I mean, but I feel money will be wasted if you spend money to try and do a national campaign knowing that we are so fractured in the way we think. Lesson three, and that's linked to social media, is that the modern consumer / the millennial, he wants a brand conversation. He does not anymore want to be a passive participant. His father, his grandfather were people who took whatever advertising, they took whatever brands, and they accepted it. And if they didn't accept it, it was a silent denial or rejection of the brand. Today with social media, and today with Twitter and with Facebook and with Insta, you have a consumer who says, look, I'm buying your product. I want to be able to tell you that I don't like it. Earlier, he didn't have a grievance. He didn't have a complaint counter to go to. If he was unhappy with the product, he had to go back to the shop and give it back. Today, he can slam you on Twitter. Today, every single brand worth its salt has got a division that is scared of consumer complaints, because today the consumer finally, after all these years, wants to say to you, I want to be a part of your brand building, because you have not done enough research. The research that you do is vast. It's a nationwide research. I'm telling you moment to moment what I feel is wrong with transportation today in the country or this in the country. And I want to be able to help you make your brand better. So this is linked to that, is that how do you make sure to keep your brand fresh and relevant moment to moment? You cannot rest on past laurels. The consumer has no patience. He has many passions and passing fancies. This, ladies and gentlemen, I cannot stress more importantly, is that, and we've learned this the hard way and in a good way, is that we are only as good as our previous hoarding, our previous topic. You cannot produce a fantastic brand and say to the consumer, now take it, this is all we're going to do. He wants to know what are the innovations. He wants to know how you're working your discount patterns. He wants to know where you're going to be available. Are you going to add something? Are you going to change your ad? Are you going to give us, he is bored today and he's looking for fresh inputs. And if you can combine a long-term idea, but keep adding something new to it every so often, you, I think, have a winner. So we change topicals at the rate of one every 2 days. Just to very quickly take you through some of the topicals that we've done that perhaps had a lot of interest and cachet. Now this, we got the news literally at 3 o'clock on that particular day. And by 5 o'clock, it was out. And perhaps this one I would say is one of my favorites in many ways, because if you look at the moment, the surprise on Modiji's face, the look, the almost cheeky look on Rahul's face. This had a lot of interesting... So controversy has been part and parcel of this campaign, because we comment on day-to-day happenings. And you will always have some amount of controversy when you're dealing with issues that are of importance. So TikTok, when it was banned, as were a lot of Chinese products. Amitabh Bachchan, our favorite movie icon, when he came out of hospital. Again, a huge Twitter issue, because when he went in, there were trollers telling him that they hoped that he would die, which again, in the history of our nation, Twitter can work both ways. It opens up an avenue of being able to talk to your favorite icons in a way that you could never have 20 years ago. And yet you can talk badly to him. So AB beats C when he beat Corona. This was two hoardings ago, when there's a whole mystery as to why the Mumbai Indians captain was not. So again, using the pun, where we use fit, can't fit him into the team, and fitness. And as something we've always done over the last 55 years is, our baseline always ties into the butter. When the great Sean Connery passed away, A Diamond Is Forever, this was the first one we ran when the coronavirus first hit the city and the country. We said better safe than sorry. When Nadal won his yet another French Open, and this all of you would have seen, it ran when the man won. My final lesson, ladies and gentlemen, is what to avoid. Religion in any form is a no-no. I think I don't want to name them, but Tanishq has realized in quite a harsh way that religion in this country is not just about faith. It's the beginning of controversy, and it's a no-win situation. So we have very, very clearly over the years stayed far away from religion, and not destroy your brand, but just you can bring it in harm's way, because religion in any form has always been a tricky subject. It's a very personal subject. It means a lot to people. And if it is used in what people think is a frivolous way, which is advertising, you're likely to have problems on your hands. So with that, my friends, I hope that this has been a sort of learning experience from the point of view of a brand that has been iconic, a campaign that has been long running, and perhaps lessons that I've learned over a period of time, if they can be useful to you in your endeavors, well, best of luck. Thank you.